Welcome back to our continuing coverage of the 2015 World's Group Stage. Before we get back into the action in Paris, let's take a closer look at Zatai and his journey from the Invictus Gaming bench all the way to the world stage.
冠军这两个字对我的意义更多的是证明了我的一个存在，它的背后真的需要付出太多辛酸努力和泪水。我是姿态，现在效力于IG，在IG打上班的位置。在2012年世界总决赛的时候， IG 和 WE 两支虽然在国内已经成为了一个比较老牌的一个战队，但是当走上世界舞台的时候，其实两支队伍显得并没有那么的成熟。当时梳理以后，没有那么太多的感受，可能在往后的世界总决赛里面继续再加油了。在13年的时候就已经没有进入世界总决赛的舞台。 然后14年又没有进入一个职业选手，就是连续2年没有进入世界总决赛的舞台，真的是一个非常大的打击。输给老干爹，当时心里就感觉自己整个世界都崩了，然后就完全的不知所措，不知道要干嘛。坚持到今年第3年的最大的一个原因，其实还是因为不服输，还想再去看一下。 当时我知道有这个决定了以后，心里也是就是特别难受的那种。对我对自己，要求非常的高，完全的根本不能接受自己是一个替补这样的事实。我和 Safe 去上场，可能效果比 Rookie 加麦之间稍微还要再更差一点，所以就没有我和 Safe 上场的机会嘛。 管理层也有和我，就是和我讨论，让我去考虑，去转上路这一个位置。当时我第一次听到管理层这一个想法的时候，我感觉这个是完全天马行空的一个想法。我说我怎么可能去干这样的事情？春季赛进行到1/2的时候，就找我进行了第二次谈话。然后当时我可能稍微有一点点动心了，因为 我真的很难去接受自己，在那么努力过后了以后，竟然还是坐在替补席的位置上。我当时甚至就有点怀疑自己，我说是不是离开这个队伍，真的没我的容身之地了。在第三次的时候，他们也没有主动找我，是我自己主动去找他们，说我去试一下看 能不能让这支队伍更完美一点？在中国更多选手退役的情况下，我就越想坚持下去，越想打下去。怎么说？一方面是因为自己的年龄可能真的没有到退役的年龄，第二就是我还能去打，我还能去继续为自己的队伍去做更多的东西，然后我也还能为继续为自己的俱乐部争取更多的荣耀。15岁的我以中单的位置参加了2012年世界总决赛，时隔3年，18岁的我以上单的位置重回世界总决赛的舞台。我会将经历了3年的更加成熟的我展示给大家，让不认识我的人认识我，认识我的人重新认识我。 2015世界总决赛，我来了。
Oh my God! I didn't know he was 18.
Yeah,
he's so
a very young kid.
He was there when he was 16 years old, and that takes a lot of just mental fortitude to get benched and bounce back from it and change roles for the team and be a team player. He had a very large champion pool when he played mid lane, and now he has a very large champion pool while playing the top lane, and he just seems to be an all-around just great asset for the team, especially on this patch. And it's a big reason of why they're even here.
I love the honesty and the self-awareness that these Asian teams are bringing to the interviews. It's something that we haven't really seen before. You know, they're really aware of themselves. They're like, should I leave this team? Is there no place for me? All these kinds of questions that we never really see brought up in the interviews that we're more used to. And it's a refreshing thing to see these players really consider themselves not just as players, but as people in their lives.
Yeah, there's been so much focus around the top lane in this tournament. So now, along with your predictions,
Is Zatai going to be able to help IG overcome Fnatic in this game?
Unfortunately, I think there's going to be more tears coming his way because of the performance Fnatic had. It was just outstanding. What we learned from the first week is not applying today. Today, Fnatic was an absolute beast. I think they're going to have it pretty easy this time around.
All right, Zyrene.
Yeah, I'm just going to contrast the performances today. We saw a great strategy come out from both teams, but the one that seemed way more polished was the one from Fnatic. It was hard-hitting. It was fast. They came out of the gate swinging, and they seem angry. And IG, if they have more secret strategies to pull out, I'd like to see them. But at the same time, that one was not convincing at all.
All right, Tabe?
I will choose IG because I think last game is not about the secret weapon, about the Hecarim pick. I think it's basically because of the misperformance of the top lane being solo killed and the bad performance of the Kitties. And you know, the red buff fight, while we think that Rookie should have protect Kit to kill Darius and Elise. But more of that I want to explain is they had a failure just now of picking the AD-based team composition, the Lulu, Janna, and Jinx, but it failed. I think IG's mid and jungle synergy is one of the top in the world. I hope that Rookie and Kakao can choose something counter-pick and aggressive play of jungling. I think they would be better to, and they have to, because we know that Kitty is a really good Cannon support player too, they have to beware of Reckless choosing Cannon and Shen and counter Kitty's champion pool.
All right, well, we're looking for IG to switch things up, maybe not have to rely on that top laner. The teams are ready, so let's hand it off to the casters for Invictus Gaming versus Fnatic.
Thank you very much, Dash. Hello, everyone. Welcome back to the cast. Our game's about to get ready. I'm David Freak Turley. I've also got Mitch Krepo Forcebulls and the wonderful, the amazing Boba Fett tattooed Trevor Quickshot Henry. It's going to be a great match coming up. Invictus Gaming up against Fnatic. It is a rematch of the first game in the tournament itself. Fnatic crushed that one in like 30 minutes, and it was like, oh my god, is Invictus donezo? But we're going to see a thing bounce back here.
Yeah, well, Fnatic, after crushing IG last week, then went on to lose their next two games, arguably off of their own mistakes. Yeah. More than anything else, Fnatic looked great against Cloud9 earlier today, and we can confirm with two European casters on the desk, there will be at least one tiebreaker at the end of the day, but we need to see the next three games play out to determine what they will be.
Yeah, if you're fans of Monte Cristo or anyone else who wants a four-team tiebreaker, you need Invictus Gaming to win this one. In fact, IG must win every game left in the tournament to get themselves into the quarterfinals. They must win the next two, and then they must win a tiebreaker, which is, you know, the very least of their worries there. Fnatic is hoping to move up in the standings, and here we go with Champ Select.
Yeah, we're seeing here the next evolution in the pick and ban phase, where blue side in the tournament more often is just banning a lot of these niche picks, these picks they really don't want to play against, they don't want to pick them up early, like the Tahm Kench, like the Shen support we saw from Yellowstar earlier, and Azir target ban there at Fevim, whereas the red side is just obliged. You look at the ban numbers right there, 89% of the time, Mordekaiser 91% of the time, Gangplank has been picked 100% of the time when he wasn't banned, I believe, so
yep.
Power picks banned on red side, niche picks banned on blue side.
And of course, with that Elise taken off the table, that's actually the most first pick champion here at Worlds. 15 out of the 44 games that has been first pick, but Lulu's now made it through.
Yep.
Do Fnatic take it? I mean, you have to deny it for Kalista, surely.
Elise has been the lesser of all evils. IG pick up here an early Kalista. Fnatic saying, well, we don't really want to go in this protect the AD carry composition. Perhaps they don't really rate IG playing it very highly.
Mm-hmm. I mean, this is Fnatic, like, they look like they're back on form. This is the aggressive Fnatic that kills you all within the first 20 minutes of the game. And when Rainover doesn't get a lease, maybe he goes for the Warrior Rek'Sai that we saw him do so well during the European playoffs. So the incredibly aggressive early game Fnatic might come back out here.
I would also expect this Cannon to be a flex. Given that they gave away that last game, it was an AD carry. It could even be a triple flex even with the support Cannon.
We've seen him in three roles already.
Viable in a tournament. Smed played a top Cannon, I believe, too. So
yeah.
There's a triple flex here, so that hides a lot of information. And IG, if they... they picked the wrong matchup, Fnatic can flex that Cannon into it.
We'll see what Invictus Gaming goes for here. Kind of curious to hover Zed so early on. I don't feel like it's a champion you want to blind pick that quickly. And in fact, they're going to hop off that right here. So even though the Cannon is taken away from the Kalista support, the Annie is still up here for Kitties, and looks like IG going to have one of the most practiced, tried, and true bottom lanes here.
Also, what IG have gathered so far, Kalista Annie is a bot lane that plays well into almost anything. I don't think there's any hard counters to that at all. Maybe skill matchups at worst.
Yeah.
And then a generic aggressive early game jungler on Lee Sin. Asakao, one of the better mechanical junglers in this tournament. So IG, they'll be very hard to counter in the early game. So let's see if Fnatic will try to match that early aggression they did versus C9, or if they will take a more late game approach. Say, well, IG overall, they didn't look all that great. Maybe we can exploit that, get to the late game, and do the signature Fnatic shock call your way to victory.
Well, we don't see a big front line for IG yet. So with the current champions on the table, there's already a signal towards a lot of combat, a lot of skirmishes. But for Fnatic, that flex cannon, I think we're going to reveal now whether that's going to be in Huni's hands or Yellowstar's. I feel like it's more of a Yellowstar champion, considering all of the top lane picks still available for Huni.
My gut was going to tell me cannon support and Tristana AD carry, but I could very well be wrong here, because that seems to still be losing into Killista Annie, so we may see something else from Fnatic.
I actually like the Jace hover that we had a little bit ago. You mentioned it earlier, quick shot here. There's really low chance of a lot of tanks here for Invictus Gaming. You know, Annie support and Lee Sin jungle are two of the squishier in those roles. So IG going to have a hard time if they get engaged upon, just based on the fact there's so many squishy targets.
Well, I mean, it could also be another AD cannon.
Sure,
I mean,
of course.
We keep assuming it, you know, it's going to be in that role and allow Huni the counter pick for top lane.
AD cannon plus Bromley sounds incredibly snowbally in either direction, because it's a double stack based lane. So if you're winning trades already and you can get to 4 auto attacks or 3 plus marks for cannon, then you can do a lot of good trading there. Also, Fnatic locked in 2 tanks, so this still leaves the possibility for an AP top laner.
Yep.
Open that doesn't really need to be tanky. So Fnatic can go both directions here with that last pick.
And think about how Fnatic beat Invictus Gaming way back in week 1. They played Sivir at the AD carry, and they recklessly dived the Invictus Gaming bottom lane of Kidd and Kiddies. Maybe not Sivir this game, the matchup in Eclipse is pretty bad, but how about Kennen slicing Maelstrom, Braum for the dive as well. They still have the ability to dogpile and target this bottom lane. It's what they won the game with last time around. Maybe this same strategy comes through here as Invictus do lock in their last few champions. Victor in for the mid lane, and Olaf theoretically in a blind pick.
And then you've got all of this physical damage again on the side of IG. It makes itemization a little easier for Fnatic, but IG have made it very clear what they want to do. They have to run at you over and over and over. And we saw the Lee Sin Yasuo combo earlier in the week work fantastically well. It was Kassa and Maple, if memory serves. They enabled one another so well, and that's a squishy Fnatic, at least carry line thus far.
At least there are those two standard tanks, the normal Fnatic lineup, Rainover and Yellowstar, big and beefy and in the front line. The tried and true formula is still there for the European squad. And then the real thing to watch out for, though, is that only really Lee Sin plus like the Kalista ult have setups here for rookies, so it's not even the best Yasuo comp.
I would like to see this cannon go top, because I think if Fnatic buys into the early game skirmishing that Invictus Gaming have drafted so far, they're going to end up getting the shorter end of the stick.
Here's
I'm wrong. Fnatic going full on early skirmish here, picking the Riven into the Olaf. Perhaps maybe going to deal with that 2v2. Actually, wonder if they want to lane swap here. Just from watching the bot lanes, I think Kennen and Braum should lane swap away from Annie Killista. But then again, Huni picks up Riven, who is so dependent on early game farm and experience.
Well, a lot of squishies are here. There's really no true tank that you consider immovable here when you come to the late game there for Invictus. So Riven going to have her pick of the litter in terms of targets, and Victor's got plenty of burst to follow up on this cannon engage. So Fnatic just look like a very good, straightforward Bashu lineup.
The one thing we've seen, though, before is Yasuo Windball late game blocking a lot of the AD carry damage and then turning the late game around. Fnatic upped around that by just picking the power on the top laner on a melee champion that obviously doesn't get affected by Windball, and then having your utility carry like Reckless, who, yes, he relies on some projectiles, but he can still position around that Windball.
Most of his kit is not Windballable.
Yeah, most of the kit is not Windballable. Obviously, auto attack AD carries are Windballable, but he has the Lightning Search to get around that Windball a lot easier. So, in that sense, cannon makes so much sense. I'm just so afraid in the late game for Fnatic if that AD carry pick is actually going to fall off too hard and IG will still be able to win these fights.
Luckily for Fnatic, the last time they ran Riven in the summer split in Europe, they played the map and the threat of Riven's power so exquisitely it never got to late game. So the home crowd, we know, are going to be voting for Fnatic on Twitter, hashtag FNCWin. But if you want that four-way tie, you got to be looking at IG. Isn't that right, Freak?
Yep, hashtag IG win if you want. There's a tiebreaker at the very end of it all. I know I've reused the joke, but it's just too good. Krepo gave it to me before the cast. Props to him for this one. Got to share in the ball. But here we go into the game, everybody. Invictus Gaming and Fnatic taking to the Rift.
I actually forgot I gave you that pun, and I actually laughed when you said it. It's hilarious. So TLDR, I laugh at my own jokes.
As do I. As do all great jokers.
When they are gold, you are permitted to. The local fans have started what we're going to dub the French wave. And it keeps going round and round and never ends. While we look, defensive line start, we saw Fnatic with a fairly grouped start against Cloud9. The threat, you know, waiting in case Cloud9 was sticking around and Fnatic stayed together, doing somewhat similar but on the top half of the map this time.
So this is actually where my analysis falls short a tiny bit, because I'm just not sure what Fnatic prioritizes more here. Getting Reckless and Yellowstar away from a poor matchup, but then at the same time, they're playing a lane that is very based around early trading and out playing because you get outscaled. So therefore, I assume Fnatic wants to play the lanes 2v2. But it's hard to guess their true intentions here.
Well, luckily, a couple seconds, we'll get a better idea. Mirrored, as far as the wards are concerned, it was Fnatic that started that invade first.
I would think Huni's Riven would do well into an Olaf early because you can always gap close. And you can get out of the accident even if one connects, and you can get to the Olaf even if he's trying to kite you, and you should be able to trade, especially around level 3. But then again, IG's bot lane, double range with Kalista, with a hard CC that's applicable target stun, that is so incredibly hard to lane against.
Reckless and Yellowstar have always been adequate laners, but never something you consider strong, which is also something you consider both Kid and Kitties. Last week, when Kid ran Kalista, he did okay, but missed a few crucial runs, felt like he was a little bit out of tune with the rest of the team, especially around the Dragon and the Baron plays. You need to see if that's been worked on over this last week.
Well, Kid has not been the most prolific of the Kalista players actually over on Invictus, but you can see, as Tabe mentioned, this team is much more about their solo lanes here, and Rookie already getting a good start in the mid lane is the kind of sort of formula for success IG wants.
So we asked ourselves what's going to happen. Fnatic did a deep invade in bottom left side, but then moved their bot lane around. So they faked the lane swap. They said, okay, we're taking the left side of the map, but we're still going to send our bottom lane to the bottom lane. So the expected outcome here is to think that Fnatic actually does want that 2v2 and the 1v1. I watched Huni do the wolf camp. He actually used this third strike of his Q, landed on the floor before the wolves even spawned, so he was actually a little delayed there. So maybe some nerves there on Huni.
And we saw that last week as well. Huni in week one was not the same level that we've come to expect, but his Gnar performance earlier today, significantly stronger. Krepo, we do have that 2v2 in lane, and you have to feel it could be very swingy, whoever gets the advantage.
I mean, it'll swing to IG side, because Kid and Kitties took the Krugs, while Yellowstar and Reckless leashed the wolves for Huni, who actually missed a lot of damage with that failed Q proc. So overall, top lane got snowballed a little bit. Reignover also started top side of the map. He's now looking to find Kakao, and he's looking to protect Huni.
And we're going to see if Huni's going to be able to do okay in this matchup right now. The CS about equal, but Flask on Olaf means his health is not high enough to survive an all-in like this. It's going to be the knock-up into a bunch of CC. The stun lands as well. Look at the chaining! And of course, he doesn't have Flash! And because of the Flask start, they read it, and Fnatic get the all-in.
Well, fantastic play from Reignover and Huni, punishing Zitai in the top lane. And on what a champion. Riven, snowball heavy, he gets a lead.
I mean, it's such a weird start for Zitai here. It's so easy as Olaf to start cloth armor, no potions, clear a full camp, recall, get five, and then TP into the lane. But the fact that he has no raw defensive stats means exactly that can happen to him. And I think it's a huge mistake in a matchup like this.
So we'll find out if it continues to hurt Zitai. We did see Reignover setting up in the middle lane. He's now going in for Rookie. Connects with the Prey Seeker. Febiven is going to put the gravity field down and will get the summoner spell.
I just went and looked back, and Kakao actually pinged the exact location of Reignover, but there was no vision. So that means two things. Either Kakao said, hey, watch out, Rek'Sai can actually end up here and tunnel over later, so you have to be careful. Or he was telling his jungler, I'm going to take this path and come to you. Likely, he was actually warning Zitai of an impending Rek'Sai gank that could potentially happen, but he chose to ignore it. And he paid the price for that one.
Well, really rough start.
Every time we look middle, Rookie is jumping in on Febiven over and over. It hasn't impacted Febiven's farming yet, but he's running out of consumables, and there's pressure from Kakao. Kakao's looking to set up the gank.
Oh, Windwall misses, though. He tried to reflex it onto the Febiven. E didn't block much of anything. Keep from Kakao, he won't keep going in, but this is really impressive to watch Rookie. He goes in every time his wind gauge is full, and he'll dodge right in, put a Q down, absorb the trade from Febiven, make him run out of mana, and dodge right back out. And you can see that, you know, he's doing okay.
At the same time, Febiven still has one potion available. He's even on CS. He doesn't really care that all this is happening. He even drew a little bit of jungler aggro. Huni's wave now is bouncing backwards. Let's see how Zitai plays this. If he's going to bait a good trade here from Huni, get his jungler to come in. Or if he wants to freeze the wave. He wants to push in,
it's a hard push. Yeah.
Oh, Reignover's going to donate, apparently might, an early blue buff yet to Febiven.
Actually really smart. Starts top left, finds the enemy jungler, or secures his top laner, and then goes to the top right quadrant to deliver like a really weird timing blue that can actually tilt this matchup because most mid laners are used to playing against each other, picking up the second blue 7:50 around 8 minutes into the game.
Yeah.
Right now, this changes like the dynamic in that mid lane matchup.
It's weird because like all the other lanes have these weird dynamics going on. Kakao had actually snuck into that top lane brush. And then Ty's like, no, I'm just gonna push the wave into the turret anyway, and not let the lane go back towards him, like breaking his own game.
Yeah, we do see the bottom lane. Early recall there for Reckless, he's picked up the Vamp Scepter, and despite the pressure from Kidding Kitties early, it's not hitting them too hard on CS. Wave is going to push towards Fnatic as well, so they can keep playing safe, keep playing back, defensive. Exactly what we really come to expect from Fnatic's bottom lane.
Yeah, and that's going to be the weird thing, because right now Kid can actually get himself a Bilgewater Cutlass on the recall right here, so Kid gets kind of the optimal recall while holding his CS lead, actually. And that's actually a very good thing for him. Meanwhile, you know, Reckless is going to sit on, you know, kind of bad items and in a weird lane without much power.
It is kind of bad items, but it does... Picking up a Vamp Scepter on his cannon kind of counters the two auto-attack trade that Kid and Kitties do, so it makes this lane very all-in-y. And the fact that Reckless has a one-range to melee... Hang on, Zetai.
Well, Zetai not going to get knocked up. Reyno, Van Hooney both decide to back away, 2-on-2. The Axe does connect. Zetai and Kakao got a very big minion wave. He throws out the Wind Slash, and Zetai... Well, just bait and juke, nothing further happens.
Well, and Fnatic had a cumulative 2-level lead on that one right there. Riven 6 to the 5, Olaf as well as Rainover being 5 to Kakao's 4. But of course, threw out of a turret a little bit too much. Good read by Kakao, and especially the fact that he stood still, which helped make sure that Tremor Sense would not spot him when Rainover came in and took turret aggro.
Rookie looking for some aggression, spots Rainover. I just like the communication out of Fnatic, though. A lot of teams, one guy would randomly get tower aggro, they're just panically attacking, but they say, nope, we're not going to go for the gank, we're just going to walk out. Nobody took tower aggro. IG was still afraid to aggress because Rainover was continuously burrowed. Feverman now...
Almost in trouble. We did see Rookie decide to back away. Got that exhaust on his mid lane Yasuo. And he decides to dive in against Riven and Victor later in the game, but it's really just been a farm fest, and with the exception of the small advantage for Huni, even across the board.
Interesting pickup here. Kid actually built a BF sword on the Kalista, and he's maxing Q, so he's going through a completely different approach. He's going very all-in style lane, and that's probably why Reckless and Yellowstar actually did so far. They did okay in that lane. They picked up a little bit of sustain so they can get through auto-attack trades. Kid and Kid is going for, say, well, if you're going to sustain up and you know, you're not going to get slowly out-traded, we'll just blow you up in one go. However, when Reckless and Yellowstar hit level 6, they have the tools to really deal with those trades.
And they're not too far from that right now, actually. If you look at the champion levels here, Reckless halfway through, Yellowstar a bit more than that. We'll see if they can time the next roughly 2 to 3 waves with Rainover coming down to that lane. Of course, right now, Rek'Sai is for the top side. Plenty of tunnels around the jungle, so an ulti can get her to that quadrant soon.
Well, we'll see. We do once again see Rainover in the top half of the map. Blue buff has respawned, got timing on it. And we do see Zetai moving around. Rookie's got caught out. The Chaos Storm comes down from Febervin. Rookie does have exhaust, but not going to get chased further. And Kakao, he may challenge for this blue buff, secured by, I think, Huni got the last hit.
Yeah, Huni takes the blue buff, so 10 CDR on Riven, not the worst thing in the world, actually. Scales very hard on that stat, especially with the Lucidity Boots already there. It's like almost worth more, kind of the way the math works out there. So Huni is still getting a lot of favors from his team right now. Like, they picked the matchup last, they saw the Olaf, said yes, we're going for the Riven. The Flex pick cannon to make sure they could kind of pick last and still make it work out. Even got the first gank. Huni is the man that right now Fnatic are relying on to win this game.
And they can, because not only has Huni shown in the past that he can do it, Fnatic can play the map and run the threat of a very strong Riven if they can start putting some pressure on these towers. The only catch is Reckless and Yellowstar have been playing so defensive, it's going to take some time before they get unlocked. And more importantly, Yellowstar for his ability to roam around on that bronze.
Well, I think it's the right thing to do for Fnatic's bot lane. They're just neutralizing the enemy threat. They're playing against a stronger lane and they're going relatively even. They have to be obviously careful of the all-in threat, but meanwhile, Fnatic as a top lane triangle is winning that part of the map, and that was their signature style. Relatively passive early game, playing on the top side triangle, and then making teleports later on work for ganks.
And you're going to see the work for ganks right now as Rainover comes across to the mid lane. There's that other point of this one. It's Isosceles, because here comes the gank for the top lane as well as the mid lane there. And Rookie losing all of his health. And there it comes in. But at the same time, a fight in the bottom side. Ulti used on Nikita to keep alive. Reckless tries to zone the team out. There's Annie so low. But there come the teleports. Huni has arrived. And holy crap. Everyone's dying in this fight. Reckless goes down. Zetai gets a bunch
down.
But
Huni, Huni gets a double.
The double. Quadra kill for Huni!
Unbelievable! and one. The teleport comes in, and Huni flashed back in. He went past the Olaf and Fnatic at the mid lane tower, and most likely the dragon.
I do not believe that this just happened. Oh, that was incredible. Huni was flashing over aggressive before last week, but now he's flashing aggressively just right. This is still the Fnatic we remember from the summer split regular season over in Europe. This is the Fnatic that so many people had winning this group, and it still looks like that same Fnatic now.
And what a swing! Thanks to the kills, thanks to the dragon, the tower, blue buff secure. Fnatic have got themselves a 3,000 gold lead and an advantage in every single metric in the game. That has to be one of the most valuable teleports that we have seen throughout the group stage.
This is what we've been used to seeing from Fnatic. Passive in the early game, and this entire trade here, I watched it on my screen already, but Yellowstar, he's getting out traded, he's getting engaged on, so Reckless not taking any damage. Yellowstar trying to get out here, and the problem is Kid, his E at the end, he gets stunned right before he can E, chains CC into Yellowstar's knockup. Huni was actually a fraction of a second earlier in that TP, and then just watching the play, what he does here, going for the bravado of this play, going back in with the flash and turning that around, that just shows he is confident and he's by no means influenced by whatever happened in the first two losses that Fnatic faced last week. But yeah, really good cooldown spacing here from Fnatic. Kid has to flash in, gets immediately stunned by Reckless. Reckless held his cooldowns until it was necessary to peel for his support. So overall, really good trading. And we can also see that Kid, if he was maxing E, he could have executed a lot earlier to finish off Reckless. But because he has running that Q-Max, he really has to get a lot of spears, and he just wasn't certain enough that it was going to kill the enemy AD carry.
Yeah, and keeping me on Nels went for a lower attack speed build as well. So BF Sword, instead of Cutlass into a, Dagger, would have changed the dynamic a little bit more as well, but all said and done, Fnatic in a sizable lead there. Incredibly though, the Lee Sin is snuck behind Huni.
Well, there's a 2-on-2, Rainover's joined the fight, Huni's gonna get the shield, and he turns it to Tali.
Wow.
He just dunks him in the spot! Fnatic have got a massive minion wave, and they will take a tower as well as the kill. I think Kakao, he started Gromp, and Rainover can sense him with the Tremor, is gonna push him out of his own jungle. Fnatic say, we want everything.
Rainover has had some fantastic game reads overall in this game. His early gank either works in Huni's favor to get a kill or deters Kakao from ganking. Then he helps mid lane a bit. He asks his bot lane, are you guys okay? Yes, they're fine. He continuously hovers around Huni, who's now 5-1, and he kind of predicts here as we see Yellowstar being traded on. Just a gank from IG, and he just robs IG of any potential counterplays. It's just fantastic to see where he's pathing on the map with zero downtime, because Rainover on Rek'Sai can always just ulti back to the tunnels.
Yeah, part of more kills, dying less, and still more CS. Kakao completely outplaying him. I know coming into Worlds, Rainover was considered maybe the weakest portion of Fnatic. Of course, a very good team. It's not like he's a bad player, but just not quite to the caliber of the rest of his team. But so far, basically perfection from the Fnatic jungler here. And though Huni's getting all the kill credit, it has all started with Rainover.
And it always is. Rainover has been the crux of Fnatic all summer long. He is the one that gets them ahead, and then the rest of the team play very intelligently.
It's like when you play those bridge builder games and you have to start on one pylon. That pylon, that's Rainover, and then you can expand, you can make a nice pretty bridge that everybody's watching. But Rainover, he is the support, like he works behind the scenes to get these lanes ahead. And we see sometimes when Fnatic plays around the bot side, Huni playing on an island, sometimes he's a little lost, goes in for unfavorable trades, and then needs a jungler to back him up. But by that time, it's too late. This time, Rainover says, no, I'm here the entire day. If you ever need my help, knock, knock, I'm here.
Yeah.
Yeah, it works.
Well, I guess a lot of teams at Worlds could have constructed additional pylons here. They would love to have a jungler like Rainover because he's completely supporting Fnatic across the map.
And what we see is every time Fnatic are getting an advantage in this early game, they are pressing for deep wards. Rainover may be pressing maybe a little too far. Fate's call has been channeled. Kiddies goes
Pepham
in.
Is coming, though.
He will find the stun. There's the support. So they have at least one cooldown. It's not the longest, but it'll also pull Kid and Kiddies away from the tower. Look, Reckless and Yellowstar, they're hitting it the whole time.
The threat of teleport from Huni. You can't do this anymore. I mean, the problem is Huni got ahead, and then IG made the mistake of ganking the 5-1 Riven, and suddenly none of this works anymore.
Bloodthirster, Brutalizer, Ionian Boots at 15 minutes.
Yeah, talk about Bloodthirsters. Kid has one on Kalista early game with Q-Max. That is one of the worst scaling builds overall because it is so front-loaded. Auto-attack Q, that's it. Your damage is done. Your next additional auto-attacks are incredibly slow. You obviously deal less damage since Kalista got changed, and you don't have the Rend execute at all. Against a Braum who can easily see that projectile coming in fights, I just don't think this is a smart build overall.
Might not even matter anyway. Even if you could build optimally in CS perfectly, Huni is just It's like he embraced a guillotine here in France, because right now he is ahead. And I don't know if anyone can stop this Huni train.
Another objective steal as Fnatic get the blue buff in the top lane. And earlier, I saw a line of pink wards in Fnatic's inventory. They've all been repurchased. If you look at the minimap, there are tunnels and wards all over the place. Febivin, he gets jumped on by Kakao, but Kakao, I don't think you want this. They get turned around.
No,
Chaos Storm gets dropped, and Kakao's gonna get away.
He baited the flash, that was perfect. He could have immediately R-flashed. As soon as the ulti starts, it roots the champion, so Febivin couldn't have flashed away if Kakao wanted to time it that way. But, I mean, he took 500 damage and burned a flash, that's great.
We'll find out if Rukio Zetai can make use of it. Problem is, there's 6k gold down, yeah. So it's going to be very difficult to punish that no-flash Febivin.
Yeah, when we've seen Fnatic play similar strategies over in Europe, they keep Huni around in this top lane until he has some damage on that tier 2 tower and we hit about the 20-minute mark. That's when they swap into bottom APS teleport, and Fnatic just become a very Baron-emphasized team. Their Baron vision denial is probably one of the best over in the European LCS, and they just take it on a whim. They have no hesitation. They're really good at calculating how long it takes for other teams to get there, so we could actually see an incredibly early Baron here with little counterplay here for IG.
Yeah, keep in mind, they have an attack speed focused Blade of the Ruin King AD carry. Even though Reckless is not a traditional hard carry, he's not like a Kog'Maw or anything, he's still got objective damage in spades.
Yeah, look at the deep pink wards Fnatic has placed. Two of their pink wards are just inside IG's jungle, and even if it takes them 5 seconds to clear, that is time you lose, that is momentum that you lose, where Fnatic will just reposition in a preferable position on the map. Huni right now, this is something we've seen from him before. Four guys are doing Dragon. He's split pushing with no vision. Huni, you don't run into the wolves. That is something like Fnatic fixed so far in European LCS, but it's kind of creeping back into their play.
So Huni gives up a death. Fnatic get a Dragon. They get Flash from both Kitties and Kakao. We'll see if that's going to be worth for IG, because the rest of Fnatic now have got siege pressure in the mid lane. It looks like Febivin's going to push on the bottom lane. So at the end of the day, a lot of net. Are they going to get this tower? No, Windwall's going to stop it, but a lot of net positives despite the gold given away from that single deck.
So hard to siege, or to protect the siege against Braum Cannon, because all you need is like one stack, then a couple of stacks get more, you get stunned, then suddenly Cannon has three marks, you get stunned again, Rainover will burrow, he will knock you up, you're chain CC'd until you die, even though the damage isn't very burst heavy. The control it brings in later team fights where your tanks are building some armor against this very one-dimensional AD-based composition, it's just very hard to play against if you're Invictus Gaming.
It's interesting seeing how Fnatic are playing this game overall in terms of their builds and whatnot. Rainover is going full tank, of course, it is that center hook Rek'Sai, but also, I don't see this very often, actually maxing W second, which reduces the time between unburrow knockups on Rek'Sai. Normally we see E for the burst, but
yep. His function is entirely CC
just
based.
Be a tank.
Oh, this could be a fight. Gents, Yellowstar, he's put the shield up. He's going to put the Fisher down. Gravity Field will block off the fight, and Rainover's got one of those unburrows, but he's being chunked down by Kid. We see Fate's Call. He's been channeled, and Huni's looking for the fight. Broken Wings pulls him backwards. Nobody's died yet. The Fnatic are going to push this minion wave into the tower.
Rookie got really low on that one. Huni managed to play his ranges just right. And keep in mind, it is still a fairly squishy Riven. Okay, yeah, she's high level, but there's no true defensive items in this champion, so a mistake can get you Yasuo ulted into death. Then I got to play it right, but this turret nearly gone, and there they go, turret number 4.
Huni teleported in for that as well. All the vision is on the top half of the map. Minion's pushing towards the bottom tower, but another objective still. That's two reds in a row, I believe two blues in a row as well. IG have not touched their buffs for the last 10-12 minutes.
Yeah, and amidst all this action, mid lane has been pretty stale overall, averaging around 10 CS per minute. That is incredibly like big if you can do that consistently up past the 20-minute mark. Febivin right now, he's comfortable becoming a really, really big AP carry, and that's something that IG's lineup is lacking. So the longer this goes, the better for Fnatic. They actually have no alternative plays on the map either so far, because Dragon's down, they've taken all the bumps. So sieging a tower is pretty much their only really map wide play they can do. Once Baron spawns though, you can see a lot more pulling around of IG members that Fnatic can do on the map.
And there's actually a window literally right now. If you take a look at Invictus Gaming's wards right now, they've got a ton in the bottom jungle. They've been covering that side as much as they can, but as far as this western side of the map, they don't have any vision at all that would track Fnatic.
Yeah, Fnatic knows this because they have two deep pink wards. They know IG actually hasn't even tapped into the river because all the fights have been centered around the ruins of that now. Tier 2 tower in the mid lane. Huni is continuously pressured up top. He died once for it, but IG, they haven't even seen the river in the last 4 minutes.
They have not. Kakao is seeing Yellowstar, gonna boot him into the air. Rookie's committed an ultimate to this, and they will secure a kill. Doesn't look like Fnatic will have a counterplay, but that's at least one more on the board for IG.
No, it's solid by Invictus. They're finding these individual picks by one member being left out. It's so early into the game. These guys are spread out. Yellowstar was out in front of the map, trying to put some deep wards down, and Kakao played this so well. Chilling Smite for the slow, so he could walk behind Yellowstar so that he could kick him a little bit more towards Rookie. Just a beatable setup there. Happy minion wave as well for more dashes. A lot of things go right, but these are the mistakes that Fnatic can't make.
Yeah, you can't overextend when your AD carry is in base. You need some help because it does look like a minor mistake. Yeah, he got picked up, but what it costs you is so much tempo in the silence, because Fnatic had almost locked IG into the perfect 1v1 where they could then use their vision advantage to then make picks themselves. So losing Yellowstar loses them some time, and IG could have potentially warded Baron. They're pinging it right now, so they are aware, but this is Fnatic typical, just burning it down.
Chaos Storm's even thrown in as well. Yellow Star does have the Fissure available. Gravity Field there for zoning, and Kakao is down. Baron secured as well. And Fnatic at 21 and a half minutes, they're looking for more.
And it's going to be Kid trying to run. Reckless does land the stun. They got the utility out of their AD carry. A flash knock at Rainover means another one. 10-4 affirmative. Fnatic are ahead.
Fnatic don't care about your vision. They don't care that you know, because they know exactly how long it takes you to get to the Baron. In addition to the fact that they know exactly how long it'll take them to do the Baron. Simple math checks out. We get a free Baron. Kakao overextends, and Fnatic looking to take their first inhibitor of the game at 22 minutes.
And the first time these teams met, Fnatic was one kill away from a perfect game against Invictus. Right now, it's almost the same. They're only four kills away. No dragons, no turrets picked up by IG whatsoever. They're getting absolutely whitewashed here by Fnatic.
What a difficult situation to be in if you're Invictus Gaming, because everybody knows that the Baron plays for Fnatic are strong, and how do you play around it? Huni's even going to use that Valor to dodge away from the Sonic Wave. The rest of Fnatic pushing in the bottom half of the map with the Baron minions. When you're that far behind a Riven, you can't run the risk of face checking.
And again, this is a must-win game for Invictus. If they drop this, they move to 1-4. They can no longer reach either Fnatic or Cloud9 at 3 wins, and they would be guaranteed out of the quarterfinals.
And if you watch the way these fights are playing out too, there's the really important matchup is Olaf versus Riven. If Olaf was ahead of Riven, then Zitai could storm in, threaten one of the carries, be it Feven, be it Reckless, be it Huni of Fnatic, and that would give you so much forward zone that the rest of the IG members really could follow up and do some damage there, potentially get a good win ball. Since he's behind, it's so easy for Fnatic to peel. Look what Yellowstar can accomplish here solo as a support. Just tag somebody, and when they're running in so slowly, one by one, it's so easy for Fnatic to play these fights. CC from Reckless is still relevant enough to flash into three people almost, because his team has his back and is continuously chasing here. So it's incredibly hard. There's almost no answer that IG can realistically, fabricate.
And while we were in that replay, gentlemen, Huni went back and spent over 4,000 gold that he had accrued, bought a Last Whisper and a Quicksilver Sash. So he really just wants to get in and obliterate anybody in the front line. And look, there's hardly any armor to speak of. He's going to be, for lack of a better word, shrekking the back line. Thank you, Pyro, for that one.
Uh-huh.
And it's just a great performance from Fnatic. Unfortunately for Monte Cristo, the dream of the four-way tiebreaker will be dead if Fnatic can close this one out. And we'll be looking at a single game tiebreaker, either for first seed or second seed Fnatic. They're knocking on another inhibitor turret.
Yeah, Raynor has 220 armor already at 24 minutes on that Rek'Sai, including a Thornmail. So also, the way Thornmail operates is it doesn't take it into account resistances for the return damage, so he actually does a good amount of damage if he gets focused in these fights.
Yeah, it specifically takes the damage you would have taken before armor and then transmit it as magic that would be reduced by MR. So yeah, it's very large amounts of damage. Flash engage, though, does catch Fevivin. Yellowstar walks right in, puts up the shield, blocks a lot of it, and now Reckless is there to buy some time. But the first kill does come through, grabbing it now. A big knockup, and here comes Huni.
He's already got one on the board. It's a triple kill for Reckless, though. They're turning onto Kid and Kitties, who are trying to run away. Quadra kill for Reckless. Kid is trying to get away. Huni wants to set him up. He's got the broken wings. He's got the
spin.
He wants the Penta. Reckless is looking for it. He needs to get it right for the order.
Set it up. Reckless did not have enough ability power to kill him off with the QW, but either way, it means the game. Fnatic up to 3 wins, and Invictus Gaming around.
Yellowstar says, look at me. I am the captain now.
The crowd go wild.
Fnatic, not so much.
They still have another game. they still need to win against AHQ. And if Cloud9 are unable to beat IG, there's the possibility for Fnatic to top this group.
That'll be the one to watch for. And of course, a Fnatic win in their next match would guarantee them a spot in the quarterfinals at 4 wins. Only C9 could tie that feat, if I understand correctly. So that would be an incredible battle. But I mean, what just an incredible set of games by Fnatic, not only today, but also back in their very first one when they looked like the real Fnatic. I mean, these guys 2-0'd Invictus Gaming with a total of 6 deaths, no turrets lost, no dragons lost.
I just think it's fantastic to see how solid these Fnatic members played. Bot lane, Reckless, and the All-Star held their own into a matchup that should leave them drastically outpoked, especially since Kid, we talked a little bit about, he was running Qmax. That's actually a very poke-heavy build, so double range auto plus Ballista, plus Kalista, Ren, and that Q, they should have been down CS for sure. Reignover secured the top side of the map. He held that triangle even. Feverman, even though he got traded on, farmed in fantastically well, and we already know what happened to Huni, so it all seems so simple when Fnatic plays this methodical playstyle where then they snowball the bot side of the map with the teleport. But they do it oh so well, and it's really refreshing to see that they went back to what worked for them in the European Summer Split. Yellowstar came out, this wasn't Fnatic that we've seen so far, well this is.
And Fnatic, they set a tournament record for the quickest non-surrender game in their first match of the day. They beat IG in 25 minutes, they might be going for the quickest average game day time of any team here at Worlds. AHQ gave them a difficult task earlier in the tournament, and that's who they will play later today, but for Invictus, one more game against Cloud9, they get to leave the stage, gather their thoughts, and now they have to come back and play against Cloud9, who have been beaten as handily. This could be quite a difficult match for both teams from a mental standpoint.
Yeah, North America as a region right now is 0-8
in the last day of their group.
Will we see 9?
That was amazing. On that note, we're going to send it down to Dash and the gang for thoughts on that 2-0 day so far.
That was not amazing.
That was amazing.
Fnatic is putting on a show here today. This is the Fnatic that we expected to see in week 1, and they've shown up here in week 2. They look to be dominating this group. It was mentioned if they win their next game against AHQ, they get themselves through to the quarterfinals. Still not certain whether it's first or second seed, but this is what we expected. Why did it take so long to come to fruition?
Maybe the nerves, to be honest. There was a lot of pressure on them, especially only having dropped games in the playoffs. And when Reckless, in the interview, he's like, we need some time to find ourselves, the selves that had gone the 18-0 in that really outstanding split. So I think they've found their groove again, and it's scary.
Well, one of the members of the team who was very scary was Huni in the top lane this game. Tabe, thoughts on him and his Riven play?
First of all, I think that Huni's play was magnificent because we can see that Zitai has been choosing Olaf for 2 games already. I think he has been practicing Olaf for a lot of times, and he's very confident in playing this. And we can see that maybe Huni, after seeing their first game against AHQ, he has preparation too. He chose Riven to play against Olaf. I think it is pretty tough to lane against him because when Olaf can finish his first jungling camp and has his cloth armor, right? But we have to mention a really important point is Reignover's start red buff is magnificent. He can just gank over the walls, and even Olaf has burned his ghost. They didn't have any summoners. They still have double flash. And I think the second point is Huni's teleport to the bot lane is very crucial. He has flash under turret, but he chose not to survive. He chose to 1v3 under the turret, and he has 3 kills, right? The last kill knock up Olaf, and the last auto attack attacked him.
And a scary Riven from that point onward is scary indeed. I want to jump on the Reignover point, though, because this was a point of criticism for Fnatic throughout the season. If people had to choose a weak point of Fnatic, they would have said that. Your thoughts there, Yamato?
It's like, I feel like this meta where you have to ban these specific champions is kind of perfect for Reignover, Amphib even. They've been playing like a few amount of champions throughout both splits. And in the meta where you can't really ban like players specifically, is perfect because on these champions, like the Rek'Sai, they are shining on them. On the Victor, they are shining, and it kind of releases the pressure from Huni.
Now, what this does to the group is just apply a lot of pressure, right? When you look ahead to AHQ, how are they going to look at beating this Fnatic team? Because we've saw the Kennen flex pick come through. People don't quite know how to deal with that just yet. We've now seen Huni kind of come back into form and show that he can carry from the top lane. Where would you attack this team if you had to pick something?
Well, the early game so far seems very strong for Fnatic, so they're really putting a lot of pressure into this. And in the two outstanding victories they had was in a 2v2 and 1v1 scenario. So if I was to take that match and be like, okay, this team is just wrecking through everybody, we need to get a lane swap at all costs. So probably go with a strong level 1 composition, Alistar, Braum, Olaf, things like that. Invade and then make sure that you get a lot of wards in the right spots to guarantee yourselves having a lane swap so that you can slow the game down and really take it by stride and not get out rotated and get surprised by the ganks. Even though we saw Kakao ping that, hey, be careful here, the ganks still happen. So make sure that you don't get these standard lanes right now, especially with the Kennen, because they are just going to steamroll.
I feel also, as well, it's very important to highlight, in the games that HQ have won, it's usually, like, they are punishing mistakes very well. Like, in the game against IG, it was Kitties in mid getting caught by that flank. Against C9, it was them overstaying at the red buff and then taking a very, like, bad path out of the jungle and getting caught there as well. HQ, like, they're looking out for those mistakes, but if they fall behind and Fnatic keep rolling on this pressure, I feel like Fnatic should take it home.
AHQ would be a scary team, though, as well, if you put the two together. Lastly, I want to touch on IG and what this team can do, although they are not going to make it out of groups with that loss. What can they do looking ahead towards their game against C9 that they haven't been doing yet today in order to come away with a victory to close out their world's run?
I think, again, when we're playing against C9, I think IG, the first thing you have to do, you have to think of how to let Lemon Nation's Morgana is useless. For example, because they must have been watching the game, last game, right? When Fnatic is playing against C9 and Lemon Nation's Morgana is simply just walking around and die. I think they have to use this experience. And the next thing is, because Zhitai is tending to use Olaf all the day today, maybe he have to change using different champions, or if he insists using Olaf, he must have a better coordination with jungle. Because the last game, we can see that when Olaf is starting to be aggressive, oh, Reignover is behind his back. And we see that Kakao is near too. He's like beside the Toad. It's just a slow about a second or what.
It's what we wanted to see out of Huni, to play more reserved and really take advantages when he can really guaranteed take the advantage to just hammer it in instead of, oh, surprise, we died and didn't get anything out of it.
All right, well, we'll see if IG can bounce back to play spoiler, because they're back on the Rift in our next game against Cloud9. We'll be right back with a look at that matchup in just 3.5.
We have C9 in our team too. We have Lemon Nation.
Oh my god, I have to dye my beard. Dye my beard red, and then we have a little bit of C9.
Everyone's dying in this fight. Reckless goes down. Zhitai gets a bunch back.
Huni,
the double kill! The quadra kill for Huni!
Kalista?
I'm not going down.
I can catch.
Honey.
That's not fair.
Bring it away.
Big knockup, and here comes Huni.
He's already got one on the board. It's a triple kill for Reckless, though. They're turning onto Kid and Kitties, who are trying to run away.
Fnatic up to 3 wins, and Invictus Gaming are out.